First, you're going to want to gather up your tools. I use a little paintbrush, X-Acto knife, and a couple, like a dental tool and a few other things to help make my Delft Clay mold. Of course, your clay. I like to make a nice solid base and make sure that the clay is sticking up against the walls real good inside the mold, because when you separate the two molds, you don't want any slippage, which could create unwanted seams. After I've made a nice smooth but not hard surface, I'm going to put down an extra layer of really fine grated clay, because this makes the piece, all the little details really come out when you do this technique. A lot of people do this, so it's nothing special, but it's really important if you want to catch those fine details. And then next I use flour. A lot of people use talc, but regardless of what you use, you're going to have to remove that. You don't want extra residue on there. So I knock it off, and then I'll use a paintbrush to brush it off. And just the only thing that's left is micro residue. You won't really see it, but it's there. And this prevents any of the really fine details from being lost due to the caked on material that you're using to prevent stickage. When pressing the model into the clay, you want to be very firm and even. You don't want it to kind of teeter-totter in the center and make really kind of weird cavities that are unexpected. I'll take clay and I'll fill in any little area that looks like it hasn't had enough, depth added to it. I don't know what better way to say it, but this just makes so there's a nice clean seam when I put on the next the top layer. I'll then powder it up. And once again, I'm going to remove all this excess residue that's on the actual model, because that would really ruin the final product, so I'll blow it off. My thumb's on the piece, because sometimes when I blow it actually knocks the piece out of the mold, so don't do that. And then here I go, I'm just brushing it away, getting rid of that excess residue, because like I said, that will really just ruin your final product. And then I use a screen again to make those fine particles of clay. This is going to ensure that the side that I find really important is really well defined in the clay, and so that the end product comes out really nice. So I'll do it until the piece is covered up and I can't see it, and then I'll switch to breaking up into really small chunks, and then I'll push it down, because if I push it down now, it'll all stick to my glove and mess up the mold. So. Now when you're packing Delft clay, no matter what size, I've made this mold, this is a large one, I use firm pressure to push it down, but I don't use a hammer I've seen people use wood. For the smaller stuff you have a lot of detail in, it's really unnecessary and can actually ruin the model. I use a knife to split it open, that's nice and even, and then I'll look at my two parts and see how did it turn out. As you can see there's some areas that the mold failed. This is not that big of a deal. I can fix that in post. And this piece here I'm actually going to put back into the other side of the mold as part of the sculpt. So I just put it back and I'm using the paintbrush to help secure that in and delicately reattach it in a way that, you know, you couldn't detect that after the piece is poured. Here's my little dental tool, help pack it down. Then we have the other side. I'm going to pull it out. I'll usually use an X-Acto knife to help with this. I feel like it's sticking. It's sticking at the muzzle, so I'm going to use the X-Acto knife and stick it up in the weaver rail to help break that apart, get that out of there without actually affecting the mold itself. See, nice and clean. Blow off any excess pieces that may have fallen out. And then you can see that the clay stuck up into some parts of the rail system, and that will affect the final product. All those little areas of clay stuck will be not as attractive on the final piece, so this one might have to be repoured. I'm still trying to figure out how to do that with this particular model. It's a difficult one to create. Now we're going to make the spout. One of the most important things with making this part is you have to make a spout that's wide enough, and I guess the width is deep enough that it's as deep or deeper than the widest part of your piece. If not, you'll get what's called porosity, which is where you get all those ugly pock marks and holes in the final piece. It creates a lot of turbulence, and it's just, in whether you're making jewelry or pouring these types of pieces, you really don't want to deal with porosity because it can ruin the piece. So make sure your spout is big enough so that you will avoid any undesirable effects while pouring. I'll make sure that there's no loose pieces that are going to fall into the mold. I'll kind of make sure when I turn it to over that anything that's loose would fall, or that I've already secured it by tapping it down. And then I'm going to affix the little clamps and we'll be ready to pour. Thank you.